Hello. In this video, we'll highlight introductory Databricks concepts, explain how to think of Databricks in the context of GCP-native data services, and show you how to quickly get started with Databricks on Google Cloud Platform. We can think about Databricks across three key areas: data processing, distributed lakehouse storage, and machine learning. Databricks leverages three open source projects to power these areas: Apache Spark, Delta Lake, and MLflow. If you're accustomed to the GCP native services, you can think about the data processing, distributed lakehouse storage, and machine learning as aligning to the Dataproc ecosystem, BigQuery Omni, and Vertex AI, respectively. While all these Google Cloud services are robust and relatively easy to use managed services, Databricks leans a bit more into the open source approach and provides a fundamentally cloud agnostic platform. Further, the underlying open source projects all feature a thriving community and mature feature set. Notably, Apache Spark's source code is available on GitHub and has over 36,000 stars. Delta Lake has over 6,000 stars, and MLflow has over 14,000 stars. Let's now shift to the Google Cloud console to highlight additional concepts and help you get started. First, search for and bring up Databricks. This is a marketplace-style procurement where you can subscribe to the product directly and have the billing run through your Google Cloud standard billing. The pricing details are further down, with the important takeaway being that the pricing is consumption-based. The free trial gives you up to 14 days or $10,000 worth of consumption, whichever comes first. Let's go ahead and hit subscribe here, and you'll see a common error, which is that you don't have the required permissions. What you'll need is an organization level role, billing account administrator. Looking at the IAM and admin page, we can see that this is the only pre-built role which enables creating subscriptions. Further, remember that these billing account roles can only be assigned at the organization level. Anyway, once you have that permission, you can go ahead and retry the subscription. In this subscription page, we're reminded of the pricing for Databricks and then the need to choose to subscribe. The estimated price calculator is also a nice touch on the right side here, but this does not actually affect our subscription. It just allows us to estimate what we might be spending. The next step, once we have the subscription, is to sign up with Databricks, which will bring us to a Databricks.com website. And finally, we now have our trial active, which will convert to a subscription after the period is up. We just need to click on Manage on Provider to be able to go to the Databricks page. Make sure when you open up that link that you have pop-ups enabled. Whether you choose Standard or Premium, remember that this is a pay-per-use billing charged by the second. You should check the latest pricing, but you typically wouldn't have licensing costs or flat fees in either case. From here, we can create our first workspace. This workspace contains configurations for how we want to back Databricks work in GCP, as far as the compute region and the Google Cloud project. Once the workspace is open, we can see the configuration as well as open it up in a new tab. Now, here's where it starts to get interesting, where we can get started with data engineering, data lakehouses, and machine learning. Let's start with creating a cluster, which gives us an environment for running things like Apache Spark jobs. When we provision cluster nodes, they'll actually run in our project on Google Cloud. Remember that the pricing for Databricks is consumption-based, and we can see the consumption per hour for our cluster before we create it. While this is spinning up, we can actually look at our Compute Engine page and start to see some Kubernetes nodes created by Databricks. We have this great visibility and consistency, managing and observing Databricks compute just like any other compute in our Google Cloud project. Once the cluster has been created and we have the symbol suggesting that Spark has been started, we can start to use this cluster. That could include things like using notebooks, submitting jobs, or using the Spark UI, for example. Now, we do want to know, as you get started, that there are three core interfaces in Databricks. These interfaces somewhat align to the three different open source projects that underpin Databricks operation. The data science and data engineering are largely focused around clusters and Apache Spark. Meanwhile, the SQL is a little bit more closely related to Delta Lake, and the machine learning has more to do with the MLflow project. But in any case, we've now got a cluster and we could start to build new machine learning models, run advanced data analysis workflows, especially but not exclusively Spark, and use data in a really flexible way using this data lakehouse model that has been pioneered by Databricks and is reflected in open source projects like Delta Lake. With that, hopefully this has been a helpful, quick introduction to Databricks on GCP. We'll keep an eye on the comment section for any questions and want to thank you for watching. Please enjoy responsibly.